Support WrestleTalk!
Give us a subscribe.
Well, we're live, pal. God, filming stuff in advance is pretty good, huh? You know, for a TV show, that way you can film it, make sure it's okay, then put it out later. Professional wrestling looks at that model and goes, nah, we're all right, and as such is left at the mercy of things that plague live production, like power failures or, you know, plagues. Bad things happen sometimes, as we've all got used to it here on the darkest timeline, but God help it, the wrestling industry finds a way to carry on. It endures, and that's mostly a good thing. Sometimes disaster is avoided by the skin of its teeth, like when Raven almost knocked out the power to WrestleMania X7 by nearly crashing a golf cart into a very important cable, you little sausage. Or an outbreak of mumps nearly derailing TLC 2017 because WWE wrestlers are just all up in each other's fluids. At Over the Edge 1999, Owen Hart actually died mid-pay-per-view and the show still went on. That's the mindset we're dealing with here. Right now, the world is pretty much in lockdown, but WrestleMania survives. The show will go on, and it's weird. Maybe it shouldn't, but what else is there to say? So, on this, the weirdest weekend in wrestling history, here are 10 wrestling shows that survived real-life disasters. Number 10, the Saudi Arabia SmackDown, our most recent entry. I think it's fair to say that WWE's continued relationship with Saudi Arabia is a controversial one. It's like watching a drug addict keep going back to their dealer, but the addiction is money, and the side effects include almost killing The Undertaker and no accountability for state-sanctioned murder. There's a global pandemic, let's keep it light. So, after the Crown Jewel 2019 event, top-tier stars like Vincent Kay and Bork Lansler left in their private jets while 200-odd wrestlers and crew boarded a flight back to the States. That flight didn't leave for 24 hours, being grounded owing to, air quotes, mechanical difficulties. There are all sorts of juicy theories why. Some sources say it was alleged retaliation by the Saudi government for Vince's alleged delaying of the Crown Jewel stream in Saudi Arabia because of the government's alleged delay in paying WWE for previous shows, or it could have been mechanical difficulties. Who can say? Our lawyers are very clear that we won't. With almost their entire roster stuck in Saudi Arabia and unable to make it back to the States for an episode of SmackDown the next day, WWE went into crisis mode and Amazon primed all of NXT to do an invasion of the SmackDown roster that hadn't gone. It was actually one of the best SmackDowns of the year, and if it leads to more matches like Daniel Bryan wrestling Adam Cole for 20 minutes, could WWE experience more mechanical difficulties? Number 9, the Raw Dark Match. As our generation Shakespeare, Kanye West, once wrote, power, air. Electricity is a saucy little bastard, promising you the world and skipping out of town with your savings. Once in August 2016, the arena that was hosting Raw got struck by lightning, robbing WWE of power, forcing superstars to get ready by candlelight, but that's nothing compared to the September 25th, 2006 episode of Raw, which began like any other until, literally during JR and King's opening spiel, the arena was plunged into darkness. The power to the building had blown, which meant Titantron? Nope. House lights? Nope. Sound for people there live? Lol, no. Thankfully, WWE have a separate power supply for their video production, so we could still hear JR and King, but it left literally the first 10 minutes of Raw in a weird, confusing midnight stupor. Lillian Garcia spoke into a mic that didn't work. The ring was lit by two small spotlights that cast everyone in half shadow. The entrance themes and microphones worked for the audience at home, but the crowd live couldn't hear them, and the show started with an in-ring promo between Candice and Lita that, again, only we at home could hear. The whole thing was absolutely bizarre. Power was eventually returned, but not after a weird half match that saw Edge as a special guest referee spearing Candice, but in the shadows. It was like the weird follow-up to their live sex celebration. Anyway, point is, moving on. Number 8, CZW uses cars to light main event. If you've never heard of Combat Zone Wrestling, it's basically a bunch of people smashing each other to death with a hardware store catalog in front of not nearly enough people for it to be worth it. That's me being a dick, obviously, because the promotion survived for over 20 years, so obviously people love it and fair play. Point is, in 2000, their wrestling show, Cage of Death 2, took place in a field which was fine during the day, but then the night came, which was dark and full of terrors. There are two different versions of what happened next. Version 1 is that the lights they brought didn't work. The other version is they forgot to bring lights. See, deathmatch wrestling and darkness doesn't mix, as one of the managers found out after tripping and falling into some light tubes, and as Alanis would say, isn't it ironic? Well, as you'd expect from gentlemen well acquainted with physical misery, they weren't about to let such a thing as poor vision interrupt their death matches, and they got several members of the crowd to drive their cars up to the ring and illuminate the bloodshed with their headlights. If you think that's mad, forget it, Jake. It's wrestling. Number 7, Raw gets a snow day. Remember this? The night after the Royal Rumble 2015, Raw was scheduled to emanate from Hartford, Connecticut. However, because that Rumble happened to feature Daniel Bryan be eliminated early and Roman Reigns winning it at the height of his unpopularity, it broke heaven, and God, still salty about losing to Vince at Backlash 2006, sent a snowstorm to f*** with Vincent Kennedy's violent remedies. The storm was so severe that people weren't allowed outside. There was a public health warning, so surely Raw was cancelled, right? You should know, Vince, by now. Instead, the show aired live from WWE headquarters itself over in Stamford, featured what has become the norm in this climate, pay-per-view matches rerun in their entirety, but also some actually good interview segments. Amidst the height of the hashtag cancelled WWE network hysteria, WWE produced an almost art house version of Raw, moody, offbeat, and emotional, with some tender moments from Daniel Bryan and some quietly sinister moments, especially a great segment of Paul Heyman interviewing Brock and Roman. Are they gonna kiss? Are they? Ah, they almost kissed. Also, they made JBL stand outside in the cold. And that was funny. Number 6, AWA bribes Sheik to shoot on Hogan. Okay, so you all follow the Iron Sheik on Twitter, right? It's like looking into a bag full of dogs. Some choice cuts. F*** North Korea, they have smallest dick in the world. Go, go Power Rangers, go, go f*** yourself. And Hulk Hogan sex tape is Stuart Little movie, and my sex tape movie is the Jurassic Park. It's like Chaucer, but with more of a focus on jabronis. Anyway, speaking of the Hulkster, Hulkamania officially started running wild on January 23rd, 1984, when Hogan beat the Iron Sheik for the WWF Championship in Madison Square Garden. For what came next, as the company rocketed on the back of Hogan to a golden era of wrestling, you have to look back on that MSG show as one of the most significant shows in WWE history. However, it very almost ended in disaster, as with genuinely Game of Thrones levels of intrigue, Vern Gagne, owner of the American Wrestling Association promotion, conspired to ruin the show. Hogan had become a major star in the AWA, but his many attempts to win their main belt were spoiled with dusty finish bookings. When Vince offered him the WWE Championship, he jumped ship, and so Gagne, learning that Hogan was to wrestle the Iron Sheik, offered Sheiky Baby $100,000 to break Hogan's leg, money he allegedly pooled with Bill Watts and Jim Crockett to revenge themselves on Vince McMahon stealing everyone's talent. In today's money, that's $250,000. Because Sheik is the legend, he turned them down and told Vince about the plan, which saw him set for life in the WWF, because honestly, as a pair of lunatics, Vince and Sheik really suit each other. Number 5, Beware of Dog gets put down. WWE's biggest altercation with Father Electricity and his sparky children occurred on May 26, 1996 at WWF In Your House Beware of Dog. As anyone who's ever owned a dog, they may be fearsome in normal weather, but they can't do shit in a thunderstorm. Such a storm raged that night in Florence, South Carolina as the pay-per-view was airing, as Savio Vega was making his way to the ring for a Caribbean strap match with Steve Austin. The arena was plunged into darkness, and then everyone watching at home was instantly treated to a blank screen. Apparently, even the benevolent almighty didn't want to watch a 20-minute Savio Vega match and sent an electrical storm to knock out the power to not only the arena, but also the WWE's production truck. The show continued in darkness, because of course it did, before the power could be restored for the main event. To make amends, WWE pulled a do-over and 2 days later restaged the matches that the audience at home didn't get to see. Fun fact, Mankind was under the ring, was scheduled to do a run-in on the Undertaker Goldust casket match. However, as a result of not having the power in his headset, Mankind's run-in was cancelled, so Mick Foley spent an entire pay-per-view underneath the ring without ever getting involved in the action. Number 4, TNA is on fire. Total Nonstop Action has had its highs and lows when it comes to its pay-per-views. Its X division was a generation ahead of its time and created some of the greatest in-ring action out there in the mid-2000s. Its Knockouts division was an actual women's division while the WWE was still languishing with Divas, and also, you know, AJ Styles and Samoa Joe. However, it's also seen its fair share of pay-per-view disasters. Before their very first pay-per-view, a gigantic wrestler named, and don't you dare laugh, Cheeks broke the ring in a dark match with his bodacious mass, forcing panic repairs before the pay-per-view went live minutes later. And of course, Jeff Hardy turning up wasted to wrestle at Victory Road 2011, forcing Sting to pin him hard way in genuinely one of the most excruciating to watch matches of all time. However, for pay-per-view disasters, you can't beat a good fire, can you? WWE have seen a few, with Graveyard Daveyard being set ablaze by his own pyro at Elimination Chamber 2010, and of course, Taker proving a bad luck charm at Mania 24 when his pyro accidentally misfired into the crowd when a cable snapped. To that, TNA says, hold my beer. And during the Hard Justice 2006 pay-per-view, during the very first match no less, a burlap sack in the rafters was set alight by the opening pyro, which was only put out when multiple dry powder fire extinguishers were emptied into the arena, all as Eric Young and Johnny Devine wrestled in something resembling the fog of Victorian London. And get this, they actually finished the match. The arena was evacuated for 30 minutes, all as the pay-per-view was airing, to show segments filmed outside before the show could carry on. Back in the mid-2000s, TNA was lit. Am I saying it right? The youth. Number 3, ECW's first pay-per-view is almost shut down. Extreme Championship Wrestling, the 90s grunge kid of professional wrestling cowabunga, aired its first pay-per-view on April 13th, 1997. It was called Barely Legal, because that is Extreme. Cowabunga. However, the pay-per-view was almost dead on arrival as a result of a horrifying incident at an ECW house show in late 96. It's become the stuff of gruesome legend, but I'll briefly go into it. Axel Rotten was booked in a tag match with Devon Dudley and the Gangsters, one of whom was New Jack, and oh no, New Jack. Axel couldn't make the show, and so a 17-year-old fan named Eric Kulas asked to wrestle in his stead. He lied that he was 23 and had been trained by Killer Kowalski, so Paul Heyman put him in the ring, where he was made an example of. During the match, as agreed by both men beforehand, New Jack cut Kulas's forehead with a scalpel, but cut too far, severing arteries in his forehead. The punishment continues until the kid is a heap on the floor, blood seeping from his head, as a medical officer rushes to the ring to try and patch him up. Cue lawsuits and outrage, and I'm sorry, New Jack, please don't kill me. If anything, kill Luke. He once called you a twat. When they got wind of the incident, pay-per-view provider Request TV cancelled Barely Legal outright, forcing Paul Heyman to literally beg them to reinstate the show. Cowabunga. Number 2, Jerry Lawler's heart attack. Moving on from scalping a minor into something a bit more serious now, on September 10th, 2012, Jerry the King Lawler had a heart attack live on commentary, about an hour after wrestling a match at the age of 62. Wrestling. During a match between Daniel Bryan and Kane and the Primetime Players, suddenly commentary goes silent for about a minute. Then Cole started to provide sporadic commentary on his own before more silence. Then, even though the camera never pans there, you start to notice the crowd are all staring at the commentary desk, knowing what we know now, that Lawler had keeled over at his desk and Cole had muted commentary to call for ringside doctors. It's a really disturbing few minutes. Lawler is stretchered to the back, leaving Michael Cole to do commentary by himself, not knowing if his friend was dead or alive. Of course, as you've come to expect, the show carries on, and Cole does amazingly here, holding it together when he shouldn't have to, when no one should have to, remaining professional so as not to cause undue emotional stress or panic to the viewer. Finally, after almost an hour, WWE mercifully let Cole stop talking and have the remainder of the show play out without commentary, apart from the occasional medical update from Cole, and again, gigantic amounts of respect to the man for his composure. Thankfully, despite being medically dead for 20 minutes, Lawler survived and returned to WWE 2 months later. And before the final entry, I'm actually going to ask you now to give us a like and a subscribe. Check out our sister channel, Parts Funknown, because you should. That would be nice. But I also don't really want to do it after our final entry. And hey, if you have a few extra bucks, why not buy your favorite wrestler's t-shirt? They could use the money, or donate to COVID19ResponseFund.org. Again, that's a very worthy cause in a difficult time. And so, moving on to number one, WWE holds first mass gathering after 9/11. Vince McMahon has no fear. After watching this video, I'm sure you can understand why. These many dangers in the world of wrestling, all you can do is screw your courage to the sticking place and press on. On September 13th, 2001, a mere 2 days after the attacks of September 11th, with the US still confused and scared and half expecting more attacks from every corner, WWE gathered thousands of people in Houston, Texas for the as-scheduled edition of SmackDown. It was the first public gathering since the attacks, with the security questions, emotionally traumatized wrestlers and crew with friends in New York. An argument can be made that the show should not have gone ahead, but wrestling always goes ahead, in some form. Vince opens the show with a monologue about how America is not afraid, and just you look into his eyes. That is not fear. That is fury. The show has a few matches, but mostly it's a series of talking heads of wrestlers offering emotional support, barely suppressed rage, and Stephanie McMahon comparing the attacks to her father being indicted by the government for distributing steroids, but let's not talk about that. This show, more than anything, should reassure us that even now, as the world stutters and stumbles with confusion and fear, as we all have to look out for each other as best we can and screw our courage to the sticking place, that of course there would be a WrestleMania. Maybe there shouldn't be, but there is, because in wrestling, the show must go on, and it will. Stay safe out there, everyone. Stay safe.